Welcome aboard, folks. It's Pilot Mike again in Lockheed Martin's Flight Sim P3D. We're in the 737 Classic add-on by Captain Sim. In the previous video, went over the electrical power-up and preliminary pre-flight procedure with you guys. Now we're going to continue that and go through some of the cockpit preparation that's done before flight. So this is not meant to replace actual training, but if you're a pilot looking to familiarize yourself with the good old Classic or Sim Pilot, looking to up that level of realism and learn a little bit more about the airplane, then this video is for you. Please like and subscribe, and let's get into it. All right, so 737 Classic has the good old Smith FMC. We've got power to the airplane, as you can see. Now we're gonna go through some of the cockpit preparation. So before a flight, you know, we review the MELs, the flight plan, the weather, NOTAMs, all that jazz. We're not gonna go through that stuff, just focusing on the airplane and its systems here. And we're gonna get our ATIS and clearance so we can know what to plug in for the departure on the FMC. So once we have that, we can start programming the FMC through the CDU here. So the first page that pops up here, try and get a good view of it. There we go. Whoa, too much. Back off. Oh, cool. If you click on it, it pops up right here. That's a really cool feature. Okay, so that's what we'll try. So we're on the IDEN page. We verify that the model and the engine rating is correct and that the nav database is active. So we're not gonna worry about the specific dates here, but we check that out before we go flying. So it's a 737-300 with 20K engines. Nav database is expired in this case. And we'll hit the line select key and go to the pause init page. And verify that the time is correct, and we'll enter the position in the set IRS position. So if we have a GPS position, oh, it does. So you can grab a GPS position here. Oh, it's not taking it for some reason. So let's try putting in an airport. We're in San Diego here, so we'll put, oh, it's not letting me put anything in the scratch pad either. Oh, bummer. Okay, so what you'd be able to do in the real FMS, I wonder if I have to clear the message first. Oh, okay, so it does let me do it once I clear it. Okay, good to know. So here's the pause init page 1. And go to page 2. We'll grab the GPS position. So that's going to be pretty accurate. And then we'll hit previous page. We're back on pause init page 1. And we just put it in the IRS position here by using this line select key. Boom. Popped it in there. It disappeared, but there it is. There's our last position. Let's see if we can put the airport that we're at. We're in San Diego, KSAN. Boom, put that up there. Okay, that doesn't really jive with our last position. So, that's a red flag, but this is just the sim. I don't know, something might have got messed up when I popped it into a new position here. But we'll try this, see if it works. Okay, so once we have our pause init page done, we'll go to the root page, page 1. And it automatically fills in what you put in the last page, KSAN. Let's say we're going to, I don't know. There we go, JFK. So we'd normally put a runway in there. We can do that right here, but we can also go to the depart arrive page. And we can look up the departures. Let's say we got cleared, I don't know, the Echo 2 departure, just for argument's sake, off of 09. So we'd load that in with the line select keys. Could select the transition here. Just put something in for fun, and that's showing that those are active. We go back to our route, and then we'd punch in our route on page 2. So we put in our waypoints on our flight plan, and then we'd hit activate and verify it with the other pilot. So we hit activate. We can go to our legs page. And then we'd, what's called, step through it in the app page. We'd select on the EFIS control panel here, the plan mode. And now we can step through it. You can see step comes up. So we'd look on our screen here and we'd step through it. So this will show each waypoint that we go to. And we verify that against our flight plan and make sure the distance is correct as well. So there's nothing really in there. It's just got the departure and that's it. But that's how we step through the route. And then once that's good to go and verified, we can execute. So we always double check before we execute. We can say confirm, and the other pilot says execute. And we can check the total distance here too. So we got a distance of 1,069 miles. We check that against our flight plan and make sure that is correct. So now we put it back to the map mode here, and we continue programming. Let's move this guy over here. Okay, let's do some performance data. All right, here's the perf init page. So you complete it from the left side, bottom, and up, and then the right side, top, down. So you'd get a cost index off your flight plan. Let's just say 30. Reserves, let's say it's 5.5 thousand pounds of fuel. Let's say our plan zero fuel weight is 90.5, just for argument's sake. And our cruise altitude, let's say they've got us planned at flight level 350. And the cruise wind, let's say it's 120. Oops, oh, here we go. I'm getting a warning that the max altitude is 33.5. Let's just put in 330 so that jives. 330. Cruise wind, we'll say the cruise wind was, say, 120 degrees at 20 knots. And then we move that up. So this is called the scratch pad here. This is where you enter stuff. And then you put it in by selecting the line select key where you want it to go. And they'll probably give you an OAT. Let's say at cruise it's minus 56 degrees Celsius. So we've got that in our scratch pad now. Put it up to the OAT window. Oh, it's not going to let me. For some reason, let's try a slash. Okay, it's not letting me put in the temperature. Let's just try zero. Nope. Okay, so it's not letting me put in the OAT. Normally you'd be able to put that in that window there. Okay, so this takes us to the takeoff page. We put the actual outside air temperature. Let's say it's 15 Celsius here in San Diego. It's a cool day in San Diego, and it's gonna be a flaps one departure. That's what we're planning. I'm gonna turn these V-speeds off. I usually turn those off so that's not cluttering things up. We're gonna get our V-speeds from our takeoff data supplied by the company. So normally on the takeoff page too, you can set the climb reduction height. You can select 1500 feet or 1000 feet, depending if you're doing a noise one or a noise two. Okay, so on the N1 limit page here, they've got the thrust reduction altitude. Let's say I want the thrust to reduce it 1000 feet and doing a noise two. There we go. So that makes that bold, big 1000. You can select a reduced climb profile, climb one or climb two. And that just has to do with how much of a reduction happens at that 1,000 feet, basically. So you can see the go-around power right now is at 91.4. And it'll reduce to about 88.4 N1 with that climb 2 selected. So if we go back to that takeoff page, this is where we'd enter the center of gravity as well, the Mach, percent Mach. There it is, it's got it on page 2. Normally, I always see it on page 1 here by the flap setting. And that's taken from the final numbers. Once everybody's loaded and we know where everybody's sitting and where all the bags are and the fuel's all computed, your dispatch should give you a CG or percent Mach. And you plug that in, let's say it's 18% for this takeoff. You plug that into the scratch pad and then put it up here to the CFG. It gives you a trim setting, 4.8. So you verify that a stab trim value is shown. And this is where you would enter the V-speeds as well. So let's say from our takeoff data card here, let's say it's V1's 125, V2's 140, or sorry, VR's 140, V2, let's say 155. So we put that in there. And usually when I put in the V2 speed, I'm also setting that on the MCP in the auto throttle as well. So let's see if I can get this back here. So I'd go here and I'd set this to, let's see, oh, there we go, 155. And I'm just gonna arm it right now. And there we go. So now I just go through the climb, cruise, and descent pages, climb. So we've got the speed limit, 250 to 10,000 feet. And then above 10,000 feet, it's going to target 282 knots and then Mach 7.4 in the transition. Up to cruise altitude of 33,000 feet. There's the cruise page, 33. It tells you your max here, so this is important to check. Remember when I tried to put in 350, it said the max was 33.5. So it'll say your optimum and your max. So for whatever reason, now it says the max altitude is 35.1. So you want to make sure your selected cruise altitude is not above your maximum altitude. And it should give you a little warning here if you accidentally do that like I did. Shows your target speed and cruise, Mach 7.4, and the turbine N1. Fuel at KJFK, we're going to still have 20,000 pounds of fuel when we get to our destination because prepared P3D here. I haven't figured out how to change this yet. If you know, let me know in the comments, but it fully fuels up the airplane. So we've got like 35,000 pounds of fuel, which is awesome. So there's our cruise page, descent page. You have a look at that as well. It's got the econ speed of 7.4, transitioning to 282 indicated, and then 240 below 10,000. It gives it kind of a 10-knot pad, so you're not overspeeding in the transaltitude transition level 180. So forecast winds, oftentimes we'll put this in from the sheets. Whatever you got on your sheet there, you can put in. Oops. And this is just forecast winds, so the FMC can help with your descent. Okay. Oh, I accidentally changed the trans level, I think. There we go. So you plug in your winds. Let's say the winds at 210 or 330 with 50 knots. And the winds at 13,000 feet are 300 at 30 knots. And then the forecast winds at 7,000. We'll just make something up here, 270. At 15 knots. You put that in there. There should be an execute light popping up for that. So there you go. That's a quick rundown on how to set up the FMC, the good old Smith FMC. So we started on the ident page, checked the model and the engine rating, the database. We went to the position init page. We put in a GPS position. We grabbed it on the scratch pad here. And then we went back and put it in the set IRS position. We plugged in our airport, we might put a gate on there. And then we did the route of flight. We went from KSAN to KJFK, runway 09 on the Echo 2 departure with the SLI transition. And then here would be our route. There'd usually be a bunch of waypoints in here along the way that we'd verify before we executed it. Like I showed you by activating and then going to the legs page. And then selecting the plan mode. And now we can step through it and look on our display to see all the points as we step through. It centers each point. And we verify it with the other pilot and then execute it. And then remember to put your selector back to map. It looks like the sim did that for me already. And then we put in our performance data in the perf page, started at the bottom left, went up, across, and then down, getting our cost index, reserves, planned zero fuel weight. We put in the actual zero fuel weight once we get it, and then our cruise altitude, cruise wind, temperature. For some reason, it didn't let me put in a temperature. Let's try one more time. Let's try a slash minus 56. Nope, it's just not taking it. We put in our flap setting. So when you do get your final numbers, you're also going to get a select temperature for the thrust reduction. So that's an assumed temperature. Of course, that deleted my takeoff speeds. So I'll just make up some takeoff speeds again. And that'll give you reduced thrust takeoff. So this FMC is not exactly like the one I'm used to. The pages are a little bit different, but it's pretty close. All right, so we do a light test before we go flying. Put that to the test position, and every light pretty much in the cockpit lights up. So the pilots look kind of top to bottom, left to right to make sure none of these lights are burnt out. Some of them, you know, you might see a little bit of a dimming. That means maybe one out of the two lights in there is burnt out. But we do this light test, first flight of the day, and just kind of look top to bottom, left to right, making sure all these lights are good and that none of them are burnt out. So these ones on the dash are really important, the fire warning, master caution. This is called a recall. Shows any conditions that the pilots should be made aware of through the master caution system. And then one additional thing we check is the auto throttle lights. Let's see if I can zoom in. So you hold that to the up and down position and check the different lights on the auto throttle enunciators. So the captain and the first officer do that. Check the gear lights. That's very important. You don't want to go through a gear emergency extension just because a light was burnt out. And then down here, check all these lights. And then once each pilot's satisfied that the Christmas tree is fully lit, we turn that back off. All right, so there's the light test. Here's where you'd probably review the limitations card. And if you've got a differing fleet, any differences between the airplanes, do an emergency briefing between the captain and the first officer, just about what to do in the event of a reject or some emergency on takeoff as per your SOPs. This is where you'd probably also do a departure briefing. So just an IFR departure briefing, detailing the runway and the SID, noise abatement to be used, minimum flap retraction altitude, engine out procedure, any MEL considerations, and anything else that is pertinent. And then we're on to our flows. So there's a first flight flows, and then there's a through flight flow. This is just memory items to get kind of the switches in the right spot and get the airplane ready to go flying. So that will be the subject of my next video. Since we spent so much time on the FMC, the next video will be the cockpit preparation flows. Thanks for joining me. Be sure to like and subscribe, and we'll see you in the next video. Thanks.